Azure Application Gateways, what they are, why you need them, and of course, how you can deploy them. But equally importantly, let's resolve all those lingering questions and mysteries about why they are so cool to use. All that and more if you join me coming up now. Hello, everybody. My name is Adam Gordon, an edutainer here at ITProTV, back with another exciting conversation as we continue looking at what is Azure. In this episode, we're going to talk about what the Azure Application Gateway is. We always answer three questions for you. What is the Azure Application Gateway? Why would you want to use or deploy it? And of course, equally importantly, how can you put this technology to work for you by getting it up and running? Let's begin by talking about what the Azure Application Gateway is. When we look at the Azure Application Gateway, you'll see it on the light board here. I've drawn out two distinct functional elements, things that the Application Gateway provides. We have the web application firewall, and we have what's known as a load balancer. I want to talk about those two concepts for just a minute because they really help us to understand what it is that the Azure Application Gateway provides. Let's assume that this area right out here, right in front of me on the light board, this is the internet, the World Wide Web, the cloud we always hear so much about. It's everything that goes on outside of our organization and away from, in this case, all of the data and the services that are inside that potentially people on the outside want to have access to. And so what I'm going to do is just draw a little cloud for us here. And let's say this cloud kind of represents our ability to be able to be on the outside, but ultimately to be able to access resources, right? And the idea is that we want to come from this cloud. We want to make a request. We want to be able to have that request ultimately get access to one or more of the resources on the inside of our network, inside of the Azure data center, wherever that may be. But the problem is we can't just show up, knock on the door and expect to get access to all that content. There's security we have to worry about. Who are you? What are your intentions? What is it you want to do with our data? And if so, if we even allow you to do so, are you going to do that in ways that we could support? Those are all important things we'd have to think about. And so the web application firewall is going to help us to manage all that, because what it's going to do is it's going to act as a gatekeeper. It's going to say, well, hold on a second there, Adam. We know you're on the outside and you may actually belong coming in and certainly may have the ability to see resources, but we got to check you out and kind of make sure you're okay. We got to know where you're coming from. We got to know what your intentions are. What kind of access do you want? And we've got to remember where you came from, so that way when we give you what you want, we know how to send it back to you. We call that session affinity. And all these things are important, and all of that is provided by the web application firewall and a lot more along the way. In addition, we want to make sure that it's not just me that's sitting out here asking to see content. It may be, but maybe there's 100 or more me's, all of you, and all your friends, and all their friends, because everybody wants to see something on the internet today, right? And as a result, there's hundreds, thousands, perhaps millions of people that are out here wanting to see content. Think of it, YouTube, right now, as you're watching this episode of What is Azure, listening to me explain the Azure Application Gateway to you, imagine how many other people are looking at content on YouTube simultaneously. They all want to stream and get access to that content from somewhere, and they're all asking for it at the same time. And by the way, they're all probably really impatient to want it now. And as a result of that, our second ability becomes very important, our load balancer. This is like traffic management. This allows us to ensure that my request, your request, and all your friends' requests are sent to the right place, wherever we want that content to come from. By the way, we could have up to 100 of these boxes on the back end of each one of these application gateways. Each box could represent a website with its own content that's being served up from our organization. To 100 of web, up to 100 of those websites simultaneously can be served up, managed, and protected, as well as balanced by an application gateway. Phenomenal scalability, really, really important. And we're going to have that traffic management load balancing capability tell us where we're sending our traffic requests to and how to make sure they get back to where we need to go. Right back here to me on my machine as I'm watching this video, or you are as you're interacting with me. So when we think about what the application gateway is, it's a traffic management and security mechanism that allows us to provide content securely to people from anywhere across the world at scale. Very, very important when you think about the kinds of things we do today, the ways we collaborate, the ways we meet, the way you share information and interact with your peers and colleagues. When we answer the question, why would this be important? We want to think about exactly what I just described. the answers to the what, and build on that. I'm out here in the cloud, just like all of you are. I'm coming through this gateway. I'm sending my traffic request in, but there's multiple websites or places where I can get content from. We need to think about what kind of content we want to see and how we're going to request it. And that's where what we call the backend pool comes in. You're going to see these, and I'll explain how we create them when we take a look at how to do this. But the reality is these are simply just collections of resources, servers, and data that somebody is going to want to see, that we're going to group together. We're going to give the appropriate information to set up and manage that resource or set of resources to the application gateway. It's part of how we set it up. And then we're going to let users make requests that are routed and sent to pull that information. Remember, up to 100 of them can exist back here simultaneously. It's pretty impressive. And so let's say we're going to call our first area, our first pool, the image pool. I'm going to represent that in blue, and we're going to color code that. And let's say our second one is going to be the video pool. I'm going to represent that in orange, and we're going to color code that. But we're not going to use color to represent our requests because that's a little hard. Instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to say that the video request is going to have the letter V associated with it. And the image request, I for image, if you think about that, will have the letter I. And when I say the letter, what I mean is in the URL, the request that I make from here on the outside, in order to consume a resource, stream a video, access a file, look at a web page, whatever it is, through the application gateway with the security of the web application firewall, load balanced and optimized for speedy transmission and retrieval of data and loading into my system, as well as updates as necessary. When I do that, we need that magic URL, that address that we always use to access resources. I'm going to say that if the address has the I in it, it should go to the image area. If it has the V, it should go to the video area. Remember, we could have up to 100 of these on the back end set up separately, providing information to users just based on what we would call a vanity URL, a customized address that they just have to type in and that we serve up through the application gateway. And as a result of that, if this request has V in it, it's going to come through here and wind up being sent to the video area. That request is going to come back the other way. It's ultimately going to wind up over here. And we're going to see the letter V, which represents our video, show up on our web page in our YouTube app player or whatever it is. And we're going to be able to watch video from our backend video pool. In order to see how all this comes together and how it's done, you're going to take a trip with me as we always do. I'm going to show you now how we go ahead and implement this in the Azure Fabric. And once we bring it all together, you're going to see just how easy it is to deploy and use the Azure Application Gateway. All right, everybody, we've done the what and the why. It's time for the ever popular how. We're in the Azure portal. We've gone ahead and created a resource group and called it Application Gateway for us so we know exactly what we're doing. We're going to use the add button, I've highlighted it right there, to go ahead and go out to the marketplace. We'll search for the Application Gateway and we'll choose that so that we can begin our deployment process and see how we configure it. Let me just zoom in so you can see where we are. We're going to click add. We'll go to the marketplace, and we can either browse by category down here, or we can just start typing. And as we start typing, and we get close to Application Gateway, you'll see that we get some options there. Choosing the first one on the list will give us the Microsoft Application Gateway. We want to create that, so we'll click our link to create. Take just a second. We'll get our tabbed interface that we're used to seeing for a lot of these deployments that we look at. And we're going to start answering questions. Now, the good thing is, because we're already in a resource group that's named, that information is populated for us along with our subscription. And we can then go down and just see the other elements that we need to provide here. Now, if we did need to create a brand new resource group, we do have that capability. But really, first thing we want to do is give this application gateway a unique name. So I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to call this the Mic1 Application Gateway. As long as the name is unique and meets the naming requirements, we want that green check at the end of the line. We're good. We see the region that we're going to deploy into, and that is the West US. Again, we can modify that if necessary. We see the tier here, which is the service tier and the pricing associated with the service tier that we can choose. You'll see we have standard V2, and you'll notice here We do have both standard version 2, V2 means a newer set of features, and the web application firewall, the WAF, and a WAF V2. We can deploy this and set this up in any of these configurations depending on what the needs are, as we talked about, as we discussed what the application gateway is, why it's important, and really the functionality associated with it. I'm going to just choose the standard V2 for purposes of our demonstration. We do have auto-scaling capability here. Let me just scroll down so you can see this. The auto-scaling capability allows the application gateway to expand what is called the resource pools on the back end to provide those services that we're going to serve up, the application data and those things, and allow the system to manage on our behalf for us how that's going to work. Minimum scale units, maximum scale units are provided so we understand how that scaling can be managed. We can use an availability zone if we have one declared. That will help us to understand how to physically ensure that the systems that are backing our application gateway and all the resource provisioning they provide in the Azure data centers are going to be resilient in case something happens to them. We actually can fail over to other resources and ensure that we can keep running. And Microsoft manages all that on our behalf. We can decide if we want to enable advanced HTTP protocol support, and we can also, and this is a requirement, configure our virtual network, either use an existing one or create one that we're then going to use to manage this traffic so that we can control how it's going to flow through the gateway and into the backend area where our resource servers, our pools are going to be, our image and video items from our Lightboard conversation. I'm going to click Create New because I don't have an existing network that I can use. And you can see that I do have the option here to give it a name. We will do that. And I can specify either a brand new resource network that I want to create, specify the subnet of the range, or perhaps take the recommended one that Microsoft is populating. It's up to me, or I can do both, depending on what I want to do. Let's just go ahead and populate this. We'll call this the mic net one. As long as that name is unique, we get our green check. All of that is good. I'm going to accept the default network and the default subnets. In the real world, as you're working through this, you would certainly want to create networks that approximate and line up with your functionality and where your resources are in the data center. We're just doing this for purposes of demonstration. I'm going to go click through to the next tab, which is what we call the front end area. And in the front ends area, I'm specifying the public available IP address that will be used to send information through the application gateway from the outside, from the external area on the internet. And we need that public-facing IP address to be available, and we need to specify what it is. And you'll see right now I can add a new one if I don't already have one, or if I only want to keep this private, maybe keep it only internal for my users inside behind the firewall, I could specify private. Or I could specify that I want both, and I can provide both addresses. So I have a separate address for customers, people that are not organizational members. They're not employees and team members, but people that are going to be employees will access the system through a different way and have a different IP address. So we have options. We like options. I'm going to click Add New. We got a little pop-up here. We're just going to name this IP address. We give it the name. Microsoft assigns the public IP for us automatically. So we're not worried about what it is. We're just worried about what to call it. We'll click OK. That'll give it a new name. We'll then go ahead and go to our backend area. And the backend area is going to ask us to either add a backend pool, or if there is already one available, we would potentially see it there. We don't. We need the backend pool. This is the collection of resources that our application gateway targets to send traffic to. This will be the image or the video icons that were on the Lightboard as we were sending our traffic into different places. I have to create those areas, and they're called backend pools. So what we're going to do is click here to use this wizard to add a backend pool. We have to give this a name. Let's call this mic image. And you'll notice over here that I can add the backend pool without targets, yes or no, meaning I can specify different kinds of targets, either an IP address, an FQDN, a virtual machine, things like that, or I can come back and fill that in later after I've set up the initial application gateway architecture. Let me just show you what those options are. You'll see IP address, virtual machine, a virtual machine scale set. That's what VMSS is, and our app services.
a web application that I want to provide, publish, and make available. And I would choose appropriately here, adding in, as you can see, multiple iterations if I need to. If I decide I don't want to add one of those, I just click the delete icon, essentially the garbage can to get rid of it. Or I could decide I want to add the backend pool without putting targets in. Right now, we don't have enough time to show you how to build the entire infrastructure out and build those targets, but we certainly can add them after the fact. So we'll just click add, we'll go ahead and build the pool without the targets, and we can circle back to it later. We'll click configuration, our next item. You can see we're moving over. And in the configuration area, we have three distinct things we have to add in. Our front end IP, you'll see we already have that there. It's populated as part of the wizard. You'll see if we want to add additional ones, we could add them here. Routing rules, this is where we set up the magic that happens with the load balancer to be able to say, send the I traffic to image, send the V traffic to video in our lightboard discussion. And then our backend pools, as you can see, we have our backend pool populated. We can go in and edit it, and or we can add additional ones from here. And once we're done with all this, we would set up our routing rules. So we just quickly show you what that looks like, even though we're not going to populate them because they are a little complicated. But you'll see we could set up our rule name. We'd set up listeners as well as backend targets. So there's a few tabs we have to contend with here. A lot of information asked for. Protocols, names, IP addresses, additional settings, and the configuration information around specifying how we handle errors if something is requested that we can't provide. All of this looks incredibly complex, can even seem a little overwhelming, but you can always come over to ITProTV. Join me as I walk through this and all the other Azure stuff you want to see, and I could show you how to do this in depth, slowly, and specifically, step by step, so you can understand exactly what to do. All you need to do is come over, become a member, and take a look. So we could set all this up, but right now we're just gonna note that it's there. We're gonna click cancel. We're gonna realize that we can click next if we wanna go ahead and add our tags. You'll see I can't get past here without a routing rule, but we could move to the tag area, and then ultimately review and complete once we're done. Hitting summary, seeing that tab come up, telling us everything that's about to happen. We wait several minutes, probably about 15, 20 minutes to get the whole thing configured, depending on the choices you make. And then our Azure Application Gateway is up and running. Then we start testing and serving up our application services and allowing traffic to be managed on our behalf. If you want to find out more about how to do this end-to-end, as I suggested, you can always follow us over at ITProTV, where we can provide for all your training needs and certainly all your Azure training needs in particular. Until I come back with another What is Azure episode, continuing our conversation around services and features that are important to you as you look to optimize your use of the Azure platform, I'm going to wish you happy Azuring, and I'll see you soon.